thank you for joining me this evening for our midweek worship service here at First Assembly of God. I greet you and I join with you for this worship service here in our sanctuary. I chose to film this service in our sanctuary for a reason. A lot of you have not been able to join with us on site, or you may not have been in our sanctuary for a few months, some of you, or some of you at scattered times or at different times. And I just felt like it would be a comfort for you tonight. And we're joining together for worship, and we are joining, even if it's over the internet, here in our sanctuary, this place that is dedicated to the worship of God. This is His house and His place of worship. Gather with me. Let's join together in this worship service tonight. I turn around and I want to just let you have a look and see that your home is still here. Your church is still doing well. I want to thank our ladies who come and decorate our sanctuary. Even though we've been off campus much of the spring and the summer, they have kept our sanctuary updated. And they have kept it beautiful. And they do it for a reason. They do it because they know this is the house of God, and they do not want to see it neglected. I thank those that donated and helped us with our monitors and the updates that we did on our platform, everyone who worked and gave and did so much. You are a blessing to the Lord. Tonight, as we begin our midweek service, let's join together in prayer, would you? Lord, even if it's over the internet, we join together in the house of God. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Come and visit with us tonight. Bring comfort and bring, Lord, just a sense of peace and edification to our soul during this midweek service. Whether people are watching it on Wednesday night or Thursday or Friday or Saturday or whenever, let it be an encouragement, a time of joining together, hallelujah, with their church family. Let our spirit lift up and praise the name of the Lord, who is King of Kings and Lord of Lords. We love you tonight, God. Lord, search our hearts. You know how to encourage. You know how to strengthen. You know where everyone is, God, spiritually and physically, financially, relationships. You know all things. You know how to touch them. We gather in your name, and it shall be done in the name of Jesus. Amen. Historically, on Wednesday nights, we would do several things here in our sanctuary. Well, let me mention Wednesday morning. We've not been able to have since March our Wednesday morning worship service, and many people would attend that. Brother Wallace Amos would bring us a devotion. We would sing hymns, and a lot of our retirees would join together for that service. We missed that opportunity, and we are reaching out to you tonight, telling you that we love you, those that came on Wednesday mornings. On Wednesday night, we would have children and youth ministry in our fellowship hall and children's area, and later we'll have a devotion for our kids. But in our sanctuary, it was dedicated to prayer night. And I did that intentionally. I know that that's not a big draw. People, they'll come to chicken dinners, they'll come to a festival, but not many people drove to prayer. But I did it intentionally. I did it on purpose because I really believe that prayer is one of the foundations. We'll talk about that a little later in our service. But if you're built on prayer and the Word, you're built on a solid rock. And during these difficult times, we'll make it through because we've been founded. But the way we prayed was the outline of the Lord's Prayer. Take your Bible. Take your phone. Turn with me to the book of Matthew chapter 6, and we'll start reading at verse 9. The disciples came to Jesus and said, "Lord, teach us how to pray." I mean, you know, Jesus gave straightforward answers. He said, "Pray after this manner. He didn't say just memorize this prayer and just pray it by memory. He said, pray like this. After this manner, therefore, pray you. Use this as a guide of how to pray. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. You start out by praising him, by honoring the name of the Lord. That's how you start. Then he says, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. You pray for God's kingdom. The first thing you do is you praise the Lord. The second thing you do is you pray for his kingdom. Notice we're not praying for ourselves yet. We've done two things already. Then he says to pray for yourself. Give us this day our daily bread. After you've praised him and after you have prayed for his kingdom, then we pray for ourselves. There's nothing wrong with praying for ourselves, but we put God first. The Bible says, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and he will add all the things we need. But we seek him first. So the third thing we do is we pray for our needs, and we will do that. And then it says, forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. We pray for our spiritual needs. And our associate pastor, Jeff Call, at that time will lead us in communion. And I encourage you to confess your need of Christ and that he is our Savior and that we take communion and remember his sacrifice. Then lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. And we pray that God will protect our families and lead us away from any trouble and keep us safe during this time of pandemic and crisis, and that he'll have his hand upon our family and take care of us. And then we finish right where we started. The Bible, Jesus said after that, for thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. So we will finish in praise. So tonight we're going to just go to the Lord in prayer, and we're going to use the Lord's Prayer as a foundation and as a way of praying tonight. Are you ready to pray? Hallelujah. Lord, we enter into your gates with thanksgiving, and we enter into your courts with praise. The first thing we're going to do is praise you. Come on, let's do that right now. Why don't you just lift your hands and worship the Lord? Hallelujah. Oh, rabo shoto rabo ho koriande de ro ro bo ho. My spirit, oh God, does worship you tonight. Hallelujah, oh Lord. My spirit praises the name of my Savior, oh God. Lord, as we enter into this time of praise tonight, Lord, as we enter into this time of worship tonight, oh God, we praise your name and we worship you for who you are, oh Lord. Hallelujah. We join together as a church family tonight, Lord. We may be in our homes, but they're gathering with me here in this sanctuary. Our spirit is here, Lord. And we worship you. We lift up your mighty and holy name tonight. Hallelujah. Come on, one more time, church, just praise him right where you are. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. Let's remember that Jesus said to hallow his name. In the Bible, there are several names that are given to us, the Jehovah names of God, that we're just going to praise him for tonight. Now, we don't have to ask him to be this. He already is. God is who he said he is. We're just thanking him for it. Lord, you're Jehovah Ra'ah, the Lord our shepherd. Hallelujah. Let's praise him for that. God, you said that since you're our shepherd, we will never be in want. Hallelujah, Lord. I praise you for that tonight. I worship you for that tonight. Glory to God. I magnify your name. Hallelujah. Lord, thank him. Think about that. Because he is our shepherd, he's a good shepherd, we will never be in want. Lord, you're Jehovah Tsidkenu, the Lord my righteousness. I am not saved by my works. I am not saved by my goodness. The glory of the Lord, hallelujah. My salvation is in the shed blood of Jesus Christ, and I thank you for that. Oh, give him praise. He is who he is, hallelujah. Lord, you are Jehovah Rapha, the Lord our healer. We praise you tonight, Lord. I thank you for the testimonies of healing, Lord, that come in every week. And you just, Lord, heal people. And I pray tonight that the healing power of Jesus Christ, by your stripes we are healed. Let's praise him for that. We're not asking God to be who he is. We're praising him. He is who he is. Lord, you're Jehovah Jireh, the Lord our provider. God, through this pandemic, you have provided for us. Praise be the name of the Lord. We worship our God, who is the Lord, and we praise you. From every end of this sanctuary, from the top to the bottom, from side to side, front to back, may the house of God be filled with the glory of your praise tonight. You're a wonderful provider. God, you're Jehovah Shalom, the Lord our peace. And we thank you, Lord. Oh, for the peace of God. Hallelujah. You are Jehovah Shammah, present everywhere. And you take care of us, oh God. And there are many other names of God. These are just a few. But would you just praise him right now? Thank you, Lord. Oh, worthy in the house of God, in the sanctuary of the Lord. We lift up the name of God, and we begin this worship service by praising you, oh Lord. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Just give him a hand right where you are. Praise the Lord, hallelujah. Now that's how Jesus said to begin your prayer, with worship of his name. Now we're going to pray for his kingdom. Hallelujah. We're going to pray that his kingdom come. You know what? Jesus Christ is returning to this earth. He said, pray thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. We're going to pray for his will to be done and that his kingdom would come to this earth. Hallelujah. We're praying for our churches. We're praying for pastors. We're praying for our missionaries and evangelists and people with prophetic gifts and for church members and the kingdom of God. Let's pray right now. Father, we come now to when we pray for your kingdom. Lord, I pray, oh God, that you will build your kingdom, hallelujah, as you are doing. Lord, there is no doubt the gates of hell will not prevail against your church, hallelujah. We declare and proclaim right now that the word of God is being preached and you are building your kingdom by the supernatural power of the Holy Spirit. I pray you strengthen church members. I pray you strengthen people by the almighty power of God. Let it well up inside of us, oh God. The Spirit of the living God burn deep within our spirit and deep within our soul. Yes, God, we live in troubled days. We are living in troubled times, but the Spirit of God is alive and well among your people, oh God. Hallelujah. And you are here among your people today. Stir up encouragement, Lord. Stir up the Spirit of God, hallelujah, in this congregation and those that are listening right now. I pray for every pastor, every evangelist, every missionary, every Christian. Lord, let your will be done in us, oh God. Hallelujah. Encourage your church right now, Lord. Encourage them by the supernatural empowerment. I pray for the kingdom of God, Lord. I pray for those, Lord, hallelujah, that are listening to me right now in Jesus' holy name. Lord, we pray for your kingdom. Hallelujah. One of the things that we would usually do on Wednesday night is minister to our children. And while we're praying for the kingdom, we're going to take a break and we're going to have a devotion for our children. We do it every Wednesday night. Kristen McCracken is going to come. I encourage you to invite your children in right now. Gather them around. Let them hear. And adults, you listen. Someone told me last week that they really liked the kids' devotion. And it was an adult that really encouraged my spirit. It lets me know that we have a healthy church because children need to care about adults. Adults need to care about children. We need to love one another and care for one another, and we want to help our children as well. So God, bless our children, bless our youth, bless our adults, bless everyone. But Lord, as we take this moment and just have a devotion for our children, help us, oh God, in Jesus' name. Let's see what's happening with Nerdy Ned. Amen.
Hey kids, I'm here with Nerdy Ned, and we are actually going to read his last story in his book. It's about the last book of the New Testament called the Book of Revelation. Now I know for all of his stories I've been telling you how you can read it in your own Bible at home, and obviously it's the whole Book of Revelation, so it's longer than most of his stories have been. But if you want to, of course, talk to the adult in your house, and I'm sure that you can learn more about the Book of Revelation with them. So Nerdy Ned's version is called Don't Call It a Comeback. Here's what it says. I've got big news for you guys. Jesus is coming back. That's right. It's all written out in the Book of Revelation, the very last book in the Bible. Of course, it really isn't a comeback, since Jesus is always with us in our hearts, though. Jesus' disciple John wrote the Book of Revelation when he was a prisoner on the island of Patmos. He was sent there because he believed in Jesus, and like the other disciples, refused to zip his lip about him. Surprise, surprise. John had a lot of time to think while he was on this island. A lot of time. In that time, he was given a message by God, a vision of what's to come. So, like, the future. The Book of Revelation is the record of everything God told John that day. By the way, I had to look up the word revelation, and here's what it means. Explaining what once was a secret. So the whole book is showing us something that used to be a secret. Revelation says that when Jesus returns, believers will rejoice, but God's enemy will be shaking in their boots. I'm not going to lie. Some of the stuff in Revelation is kind of scary, but a lot of it is really awesome too. Here's a little of what John saw. It's kind of like a treasure map. How cool is that? He saw the door of heaven open up and a voice call him. He saw people dressed in white and wearing crowns. Other heavenly beings were there, and everyone was worshiping God. He saw heavenly beings bow down and worship Jesus, and he saw a city of God more beautiful than anything he'd ever laid eyes on. John saw believers enter into heaven and crystal water flowing through the city. What did John do when he saw all of this? I guess what we'd all do. He fell down and worshiped too. Jesus told him that the invitation to heaven is for all people, not just the cool kids. Here's, I guess, what Nerdy Ned thought it might look like. So I guess that would be Jesus. But only those who hear and obey can share in its blessings. Then Jesus made this cool and amazing promise. Surely, I come quickly. I like what Mr. Kinnear, my youth leader, said when I asked him about the Book of Revelation. He said, it's about Jesus coming back to fix up this really broken place, which is the world. It's Jesus saying to us all, I'm on my way. Don't worry. I'll be there sooner than you think. I really like that, and I'm waiting. Did you hear that, Jesus? Ned Wiley is waiting for you. That's at 2613 McDougal Court. And I can't wait to meet you in person. I know it's going to be the best day ever, whether it's tomorrow or in 90 years. No one knows. So that is the end of Nerdy Ned's book. Now, I only read most of what's in the New Testament. So there's this whole beginning of the book that we didn't even read together. So over time, I don't know. We'll see. We might check it out. Thanks, guys.
Thank you, Kristen. We are praying for our children. We're praying for our teenagers. We're praying for our young adults. We're praying for our adults. We're praying for seniors. Every single person is a part of God's kingdom. On Wednesday night, we would always pray for our missionaries, and we're going to go to the Lord in prayer right now for our missionaries. We support about 35 missionaries, 25 to 35, depending on how we count them, but there are so many that I just can't mention because they serve in sensitive areas around the world, and to mention them would just be irresponsible. But I do want us to pray. Now, here are some of our home missionaries in the United States that I can mention. We our own food and clothing ministry here at First Assembly that ministers to people in need. Jeffrey and Aileen Staunt, Youth Alive, helping teenagers. Jeffrey and Rebecca Wiles, MAP RV Ministries that travel around the country and help build churches labor-free in their retirement years. We pray for all the MAP's ministries. Reginald Stone, a former pastor here at First Assembly that spent his life as a missionary in the Central America, now is planting churches among Spanish-speaking church people here in the United States. Chi Alpha College Ministries on college campuses for Christian students that are on campus. Southeastern University, our regional college in Lakeland, Florida. Abortion Alternatives and Crisis Pregnancy Center here in Bristol, Virginia. Appalachian District School of Ministry that helps train ministers in our church district. Appalachian Teen Challenge that helps people with life-controlling problems. A graduate of that ministry that is here locally now, Tri-Cities Recovery with Mark Mitchell that is helping people, so many people that have gone through that ministry. Charles Atkinson with Radio Bible Strong Ministries that is on locally here every morning, WZAP at 9 a.m. I encourage you to listen in. Age Ministers Assistance for retired Assemblies of God ministers. Lattice Campbell in helping develop churches here in the United States. And just listen to some of the areas that we support our missionaries on foreign fields. Mongolia, Guatemala, the Netherlands, Cambodia, India, Taiwan, Zanzibar, Iceland, Latin America, several in China, Kenya. And I just want us to pray for each one of these missionaries. Would you just stretch forth your hands? I have the list right here, and I want to just lay my hand upon this, and I'm going to ask us to pray. Would you? Let's pray right now. Father, in the name of Jesus, oh, Spirit of God, come and minister to these missionaries, their families, their homes. Oh, God, the Bible says you will build your church. Come on, church, pray with me right now. I pray for these missionaries, and I pray, Lord, that you will touch them in the name of Jesus. I pray you will build your church. Let the name of Jesus be proclaimed by the power of the Holy Spirit. Build your church, Lord, in Jesus' name. God, I pray for every single one, Lord, here at First Assembly that invest in missions with their missions offerings, Lord. God, I pray you flow back into their homes. You flow back into their lives. You flow back into their families, Lord. In the name of Jesus, we pray, Lord. God, let it be so. Oh, I'm praying that, and I want to thank you for giving your missions gifts, your tithe, and your offerings, because that's how the kingdom of God is supported. That's how we support these missionaries and do the work of God. And I'm just believing it's going to flow back into your life. Before we finish praying and ministering to the kingdom of God, I want to give just about a 3 to 5 minute devotion. This past week, I was just sort of browsing the internet. I like to look through and look to see what different ministers are preaching. And it helps me know what God is saying in his kingdom and what God is laying upon different people's hearts. And I saw two sermons this week that really spoke to me. One was simply a devotion, one was a sermon, so I give them these ministers credit. A lot of what I'm speaking today didn't come originally from me. But one sermon or one devotion said, the halftime score doesn't count. Now you sports fans know what I mean. The only score, I've never seen a statistic in the NFL of the teams that were leading the most at halftime. It doesn't matter. The only thing that matters is the team that's ahead at the end of the game. And another minister preached a sermon that said, we're not ready for the fourth quarter. And he just said that a lot of Christians The way you've been serving the Lord got you through the first quarter, the second quarter, and the third quarter, but it's not going to get you through the fourth quarter. The Bible says that in the end, perilous times will come. How bad will times get before Jesus comes? I don't know. I don't know. But the Bible says that it's going to get hard. I don't think, whether it's now or in the future, I don't know. But way down the road, the Lord might lift these things and we have a time of back to somewhat near normal. I don't know. But I do know this, Jesus is coming. And I believe before his coming, it will be worse than it is now at some point. But here's the thing, we've got to be able to endure to the end. In the book of Matthew chapter 24 and 13, the Bible says, "But he that shall endure to the end shall be saved." And I go back to what the Spirit was speaking to these two ministers. One, what's happening at halftime, right now, it looks like the devil's winning, and it will look that way, perilous times. But in the end, God's going to win. But we have to endure to the end. And then also this other minister that said, the way we've been living. And I'll tell you what he said. He said, "You guys aren't reading the Bible on a regular basis. You aren't praying like you should. You aren't fasting." There's a lot of people in churches that it got them through the first quarter, the second quarter, the third quarter, but it's not going to get them through the fourth quarter when it's really difficult times. Both of these were Pentecostal preachers and actually men that I know. But let me go back to what I said at the beginning, that a lot of people weren't interested in prayer. A lot of people likes to come to church when there's a dinner or there's a big celebration or there's a big time. But not too many people were interested in coming and praying. But what Jesus said, "Those of you that build your life on my words, when the storms hit, you'll endure because your house was built on a solid rock." We've got to have our house built on a solid rock if we're going to endure to the end. So I want you to think about that for a little bit. And where's your house built? Well, we want to build our house and we want to be able to endure to the end. Let me finish by saying this, just a little word from the Lord. I've said for years that in the American church, there was a lot of fluff. Now, I'm not talking necessarily about you or our church, but I'm saying that I would look at these great services in stadiums where they have worship services, praise services, and worship. There'd be thousands of people come, and I'd see these big services on TV. And I just thought to myself, if all of these people were really seeking you and serving you and really putting you first, we'd see dramatic change in America. But there is a remnant. I ask you, during these times, draw close to God. The Bible says if we will draw close to Him, He will draw close to us. Hallelujah. And endure to the end, but we're not going to make it unless we're ready for the fourth quarter. We've got to finish the game and be on the winning side. Let's pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, we have worshiped you. We are praying for your kingdom, and I'm praying for your church. We're going to come back, and then we're going to pray for our needs because that is right. In Jesus' name, amen. We're going to have a worship song right now. So let's praise the Lord and worship Him, and then we will come back to stage three. Give us this day our daily bread, and we will pray for our personal needs. Let's worship with this song. So amazing, Jesus. Us as we worshiped him. We have hallowed his name. We have prayed for his kingdom. Now it's time that we pray for our personal needs. What are your needs that you want to take to the Lord tonight? Well, the Lord knows, but I think it'd be good that we just tell him our needs. I rejoice in the testimonies that I hear. I've heard testimonies this week of good reports that people have received. Physical reports, financial reports, relationships, different things. God is faithful to his people. But let's go to the Lord right now for your personal needs. Let's go, would you? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we come to you tonight, Lord, for the needs of our individual lives. We pray, O Lord, hallelujah, God, that you would undergird us. By your stripes we are healed, Lord. I pray for those that are needing physical healing tonight, Lord. I'm praying for those, God, that are needing touches in their family, O Lord, that are needing undergirding in their homes, O God. You are the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. God, raise up a standard for our homes, Lord. God, raise up a standard in our families. God, we proclaim and declare tonight that the church of the living God is alive. You're the Lord of our families, the Lord of our homes, and we praise you for it tonight, Lord. Hallelujah, in the mighty name of Jesus. Hallelujah. That is our declaration that God, you are on the throne, and we praise you tonight, Lord. God, I will not fail to give you the testimonies that come in the name of Jesus for healing. I'm believing that cancer will bow at your feet, that God, back trouble, heart trouble, we've seen these testimonies in our congregation. I'm believing for financial miracles, miracles of business, Lord, miracles of home and relationships. And if someone walks away and leaves us, God, let the true and the faithful be true to you, and you will raise them up out of the ashes, and you will restore life to them. What someone has taken away, you have better. Oh, God, in the name of Jesus. I just want to remind you, I'm praying Isaiah 61, and he said that out of the ashes of generations, he would raise up people. You may have come from a home where they have been just horrible for generations, but hallelujah, when you come to know the Lord, he's going to raise you up, and you're going to be something far different. You're going to be blessed. You're going to be the people of God. And out of the ashes, he's going to raise you up. I just thought there may be someone that's lost a companion or they've been unfaithful, they've left. You just be faithful to God. He will raise you up out of those ashes, and in time, it'll be better than you could have ever imagined, because God is faithful. Lord, we pray for our personal needs. We pray, oh Lord, for, oh God, the needs of our, put Jesus first. Seek ye first the kingdom of God, and he'll meet all your needs. Amen. Hallelujah. We're now going to, Lord, you told us if we would pray and forgive others, that God, you would forgive us. We're going to pray for the Lord to forgive us of our sins. I've been saved since 1975. But Lord, tonight we confess our need of our Savior. Oh God, I confess that Jesus is the Son of God. Say that right now. We do. We confess you, Lord. We acknowledge our need of you as Savior. We acknowledge our need of you, Lord, and we confess that. Hallelujah. Do that right now. Just say, God, continually, day by day, I confess my need of you, Lord. And Lord, I forgive others. I give them an opportunity. I don't condone, but I forgive. Lord, I know that if they will call out upon you, you will save them, and I lead them to the cross. And Lord, if we forgive them and give them a chance to be saved, just like we had a chance. See that cross? That's where we came. Let's let them come to the cross. They have a chance to be saved. Then God will just flow over us. Lord, let that happen right now. As we lead them to the cross and as we give them an opportunity, Lord, hallelujah, you will save us. Oh, I love taking communion on Wednesday night. Our associate pastor, Jeff Gall, is going to come and lead us in a time of communion. Let's join with him. This is a very, very special moment. Amen.
Hello, everyone. It's my honor to join you once again here for a few moments in our service this evening to share with you in communion. As I have the last several weeks, just want to remind you, if you don't have your communion elements available, you can pause the video right here. You can go and grab those things, get some juice, some bread, a cracker, some water, if that's all you have available to you. If you happen to not have those, that's okay. We can still celebrate spiritually, because the most important thing about our communion service is that we remember the sacrifice of Jesus Christ. So we're going to do that tonight, and we're going to read how Paul instructed the church at Corinth and us so many years later in taking and receiving communion, and what the importance and the sacrifice that Christ made. So we're going to read from 1 Corinthians chapter 11, beginning at verse 23. It says this: "For I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'Take, eat, this is my body which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me.'" Verse 25, "In the same manner, he also took the cup after supper, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death till he comes.'" And that's what we're doing this evening. We are proclaiming that Jesus is the only Son of God, that he came to this earth, that he lived, he received punishment that was due for us, and he took upon himself. He died, was placed in a borrowed tomb, and on the third day he rose again. And we believe now he is seated at the right hand of the Father, and Scripture tells us that he is making intercession for the saints. So if you have those elements ready, let's take communion together. Let's take the bread, and let's pray over that bread and thank God for the broken body of Jesus Christ. Let's pray together. Father, we are so thankful for that body that was broken, that this bread represents. And as we break this bread together tonight, we remember the brokenness, we remember the suffering, we remember the punishment that Christ took upon himself. Lord, your word says that that punishment was for our peace, it was for our freedom, it was for our healing, and we are so grateful for that punishment tonight. And we remember that sacrifice. We ask these things, ask that you bless this in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's take together. And the cup remembers the blood that was shed. And Scripture tells us that without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sins. So we know that as we celebrate tonight, as we remember the sacrifice of Jesus, as we remember the blood that was poured out, we are thankful that we can be set free by this blood. Not just have our sins covered, but our sins washed away. Scripture tells us that when we're washed by the blood of Christ, it makes us as white as snow. We become a new creation when we accept that blood to cleanse our sins away. So let's thank God for that sacrifice tonight. Lord, we thank you for the blood that was poured out. God, we are so grateful that you have made a way to wash our sins away from us. Your word says, Father, that you remove our sin from us as far as the east is from the west. Lord, and we understand that it's because of that shed blood of Christ that you can wash our sins away. Not just cover them for a little while, Lord, but you can wash them completely away. And we can stand in your presence justified as if we had never sinned. And we're so grateful for that blood tonight. In Jesus' name, amen. And let's take just a moment, church, to worship together and thank God for that sacrifice. Father, we are so thankful that you would send your one and only Son. Jesus told Nicodemus in one of the most quoted scriptures in all of the Bible, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life." And he goes on to say, "For the Lord did not send him into the world to condemn the world, but through him the world might be saved." God, we are so thankful for that truth tonight. Lord, that you gave up your Son because of your great love for us. You didn't send him to condemn us, but you sent him to set us free. And we're so thankful. We remember the sacrifice tonight, and we worship you for that freedom. We honor you tonight, Lord, and we give you the glory and the honor in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Amen. Church family, we love you. We're so grateful to be able to have this opportunity to invest in your life. We just ask that you continue to invest in your relationship with Christ. Be in God's Word. Spend time in prayer. Spend time with your family in God's Word. Those things are so important for your spiritual formation and for the formation spiritually of your family. We love you, and we're so grateful for you.
Thank you so much, Pastor Jeff. What a very special time for the church family to join together in wonderful Holy Communion. Thank you. Jesus said to pray for your family that we would not be led into temptation and that he would protect us from the evil one. Lord, lead us not into temptation, God. Protect our family. Lead us away, oh God. Hallelujah. Oh God, protect our children that no harm would ever come to them. God, in the name of Jesus, build a hedge around our marriages that no temptation would come near us, God. Lord, around our children, around our homes, oh Lord, around our people, oh God, let no temptation come our way, oh Lord. Oh God, give us safety and blessing, oh Lord, from the name of Jesus. Hallelujah, in Christ's name, amen. Let me say something to you as parents and as teenagers and even children or grandparents. Don't let anything into your home that would bring in the kingdom of the devil. Be careful what you watch on television. Be careful where your children go. Be careful where you as adults go. Don't associate yourself with anything that would bring dishonor to you. Man, we don't have time. We don't have time for that. Jesus is coming. We're in the fourth quarter. I do believe that. Get rid of things of the world. Get rid of things that would lead our homes, our families into temptation. Oh, hallelujah. Well, we've come to the end of our prayer tonight. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory. We're going to finish right where we started. Let's finish our prayer meeting by praising him tonight. Lord, we have met tonight in a time of prayer, in a time of worship. It's been so good. I've felt your presence. I've felt your family, Lord, worshiping. I've felt, oh God, your kindred spirit among us. Oh, Lord, in the name of Jesus, bring peace to us. We worship your holy name. Hallelujah. Let's praise him as we finish tonight. Glorious and wondrous and mighty is your name, oh, Lord. Hallelujah. From top to bottom of this sanctuary, front to back, side to side, we lift up your holy name and we praise you tonight. Hallelujah. Whether you've watched on Wednesday night, Thursday, Friday, whenever it is, thank you for joining us in our midweek prayer meeting. I don't know what we'll do this coming Sunday. We're going to meet Thursday night by Zoom meeting on our computers as our church leaders, department heads, and our board. We're looking at the numbers, man. They just continue to rise. I ask for your prayer. I don't know if we'll meet in-house or we'll meet online only. We will see. Lord, lead us and guide us as a church. We never want to fail you in any way. We want to be faithful to you, to do the right thing and what would be pleasing to you, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. But there is one thing I can promise you. We're doing our best. These are not easy times for church leaders. Man, it's a tough time. But God is faithful. I'm not going to speak negative. I'm going to speak positive. God is faithful, and he is with his church. I love you, and I'll be in touch, and I'll let you know about Sunday. But worship the Lord, serve. Oh, let me remind you about our family altar. And please, in your homes at night, get your family together and pray and look at the Word of God. Our churches, our homes, our nation needs it so much. God bless you. I love you. I'll be seeing you soon.